Good morning friends, I am Srishti Jain and today we are going to do 5 questions of finance. I hope that you're liking the series. Do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. Now, starting with the first question for today. The first question says, doing business index measures regulations across 190 countries in 12 business regulatory areas to assess the business environment in each economy. 10 of these indicators were used to estimate an ease of doing business score this year over the 12 months ending April 30, 2019. Which of the following are the two indicators which are not included for the DB score, that is doing business score and ranking? So the question says that doing business index measures in 12 business regulatory areas, but for the measurement of DB index 2020, only 10 indicators have been considered. So which among these 12 indicators, that is two indicators, is not considered for the calculation of DB index 2020? So 5 options have been given to you. So before answering the question, let's first see that what is doing business index in the next slide. So this study looks at rules affecting a business from inception through operation to winding down. So there are total 12 areas of business regulation. So let's see what are they. Firstly, starting a business. Then comes dealing with the construction permits. Then getting electricity. Registering of the property. Then we have getting credit. The next one is protecting the minority investors. Then we have paying of taxes, trading across the borders. Then we have enforcing the contracts and resolving insolvency. So these are the 10 indicators which have been considered for DB index 2020. Now those two indicators which are not considered this time, they are regulation on employing workers and contracting with the government. So as you can see, what is measured in doing business? Opening a business, then we have getting a location, accessing finance, dealing with day-to-day operations, and then operating in a secure business environment. And this ease of doing business index is by World Bank. So out of 190 economies, it ranks each and every economy, and New Zealand is at the first place with a score of 86.8 out of 100. And this doing business also looks at which economies improved the most. So doing business 2020 found that the 10 economies that improved the most in their ease of doing business score were Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Bahrain, Tajikistan, Pakistan, Kuwait, and to our amaze, India is one of those 10 improved economies. As India made trading across borders easier by cutting the cost and time associated with the border and documentation requirements. So this is one of the most reliable index in this area. Now let's move back to the question to answer it. Now the correct answer here is regulation on employing workers contracting with the government. So the answer is 3 and 4, that is option A. Now moving on to the next question for today. The question says the banks in India should be rated on a 5-point scale widely based on the international CAMELS rating model. Which committee has suggested the above mentioned reform in the banking sector? So the answer to this question is option B, that is Padmanabhan Committee. In the next slide, we will be seeing the major changes, major recommendations brought by these 4 committees, and then we'll also see what CAMELS rating model is. So Narasimham 2 committee, it basically focused on the issues like size of the banks and capital adequacy. And the second Narasimham committee was brought in 1998. And it is also known as the Banking Sector Committee because it was told to review the banking reform progress and design a program for further strengthening the financial system of India. So as I have already told you, its major areas of concern were capital adequacy, size of the banks or the bank mergers, bank legislation. Now we have the Padmanabhan committee. So it recommended the 5-point rating, which was based on upon the CAMELS model. So this committee recommended that banking supervision should focus on the parameters of the financial soundness, managerial and the operational efficiency and firmness. Now we will be discussing this CAMELS model in the next slide. Before that, we will be discussing what Ghosh committee and Abid Hussain committee recommended. Ghosh committee relates to the frauds and malpractices in banks, and the Hussain committee, it related to the development of capital markets in India. Now let's move on to the next slide for understanding what CAMELS model is. Now firstly, you must know that this system is a comparative method. So therefore you must have at least two banks so that you could compare easily, and they are required for applying this system. Now CAMELS is the acronym for C is for capital adequacy, A is for asset quality, M management, E earnings, L liquidity and S is for sensitivity. So CAMELS is a recognized international rating system that bank supervisory authorities use in order to rate the financial institutions. So here a rating of 1 is considered the best and a rating of 5 is considered the worst for each factor. Now here the examiners assess that the institution's capital adequacy through capital trend analysis. So to get a high capital adequacy rating, institutions must also comply with interest and dividend rules and practices. Asset quality, it covers an institution's loan quality, which reflect the earnings of the institution. Then we have management. Management assessment determines whether an institution is able to properly react to financial stress. So this component rating is reflected by the management's capability to point out, measure, look after and control risk of the institution's daily activities. Then we have earnings. All institutions' ability to create appropriate returns, to be able to expand, retain competitiveness and add capital is a key factor in rating its continued viability. Then we have liquidity. So to assess a company's liquidity, examiners look at the interest rate risk sensitivity or the availability of assets that can be easily be converted to cash. And lastly, we have sensitivity. So sensitivity covers how particular risk exposure can affect the institutions. So based upon these 6 factors, ranking is done to the financial institutions to see that which one is the best and which one is the worst. Now, moving on to the next question for today. The question says, a willful defaulter is deemed to have occurred if the borrower has not met the repayment obligations despite having the capacity to do so. Who decides whether a borrower is a willful defaulter or not? So, the answer to this question is bank as per the RBI guidelines, that is option C. Now, we will be looking at that what willful defaulter means. And what is the meaning of deemed willful defaulter? On what basis does a particular person considered as a deemed willful defaulter in the next slide? So in any loan transaction, there is a lender to which any amount is due, provided it is arising on account of any banking transaction. Then we have unit. So what is unit? The unit includes individuals or juristic persons or all the other forms of business enterprises, whether incorporated or not. Now we will be looking at what willful default is. So the first case is where the unit has defaulted in meeting its payment or the repayment obligations to the lender, even when it has the capacity to honor the said obligations. So suppose Mr. A has taken a loan from bank, and even if A has the capacity to repay the obligations, then also he is not willing to give it to bank and he defaults. So this is one category, one type when the unit is considered to be deemed to be a willful default. Then we have the next, the unit has defaulted in meeting its payments or the repayment obligations to the lender and he has not utilized the finance from the lender for the specific purpose for which the finance was availed of, but he has diverted the funds for other purposes. Now, this is the diversion of funds. So suppose you are taking a loan for long-term purposes of your business, but you are utilizing the funds of that loan for the short-term working capital. So diversion basically means if you are taking a loan for a specific purpose, but you are using that for some other purpose, but it relates to the same business. Then we have siphoning of funds. Now what is it? So it refers to the occurrence of a situation that the unit has failed in meeting its payment or the repayment commitments to the lender bank, and also the funds borrowed from the bank was not utilized for the specific purpose for which the credit was released. So in addition to utilizing the funds for the purpose unrelated to the operation of the unit. So the funds here, they are used with regard to the some other operation and not the same business. So in order to decide that whether the funds here are siphoned or not, it should be decided by taking into consideration the objective facts and circumstances of the case. Then we have, if the unit has defaulted in meeting its payment to the lender and he has also disposed of or removed the fixed assets or the movable fixed assets or the immovable property which has been given for the purpose of securing a term loan without the knowledge of the bank or lender. So here, if A has given some property as a backing and he has taken a loan from a bank, and if A has sold this property, that is he has disposed of or removed the property without the knowledge of the bank, then also he will be considered as a willful defaulter. So with this, we have discussed all the four cases where a willful default would be deemed to have occurred. Now, moving on to the next question for today. The question says, prior to 2015, there were 5 regulatory bodies of financial institutions in India. In 2015, FMC, or we say it as Forwards Market Commission, it was merged, which turned the total regulatory bodies to 4. So with which of the following regulatory bodies FMC was merged? So prior to 2015, there were 5 regulatory bodies, that is FMC, RBI, SEBI, IRDA and PFRDA. It relates to insurance, it relates to pension funds, then SEBI relates to the capital markets, RBI relates to banks and the apex body, and FMC related to the forward market. But after 2015, FMC was merged with SEBI. So the correct answer here is option B. So it was one of the major merger of regulatory bodies in India, and this merger was because of the failure by the FMC, because National Spot Exchange Limited scam was there, and which involved a payment crisis of more than 5000 crore. So it was decided to merge FMC and SEBI to make the system more efficient. Now, as we all know, FMC has been regulating the commodities markets since 1953, but because of this failure and to make the system more powerful and efficient, it is merged with SEBI. And since then, only 4 regulatory bodies are there. Now, moving on to the last question for today. The Global Hunger Index is an international tool designed to comprehensively measure and track hunger at global, regional, and national levels. So, which of the following factor is not a basis of GHI measurement? So, firstly, we'll understand that what GHI is, and then we'll come back to this question to answer it. So, Global Hunger Index is an international tool which is designed to comprehensively measure and track hunger at global, regional, and national levels. So, GHI scores are calculated each year to assess the progress and setbacks in the combating hunger. So, they help raise awareness and understanding of the struggle against hunger, and they provide a way to compare the levels of hunger among the countries. So, GHI is based on four indicators, and they are undernourishment, that is, it measures the share of the population which is undernourished. Then we have three terms here: child wasting, stunting, and mortality. So, it is very important for you to understand the difference between these three terms. Starting with child wasting. So, here remember, child wasting is low weight for their height, reflecting acute undernutrition. And this is for the children under the age of 5. Child stunting means the share of children under the age of 5 again. That means low height for their age. If they have a lower height as compared to what they should have, then it is known as stunted. And child wasting is if a particular child is having a low weight according to his or her height, then that is child wasting. So this relates to weight and height, and child stunting relates to height as according to the age. Then we have child mortality. Again, it is for the children under the age of 5. So it measures the mortality rate of these children. So, India's position as per GHI score is GHI 2019 puts India at 102 out of 117 countries. Now, moving back to the question to answer it. So, the correct answer is child fertility. And instead of child fertility, what should have been the fourth indicator here? That should be child wasting. Now with this, we have completed 5 questions of finance for today. Hope that you have understood this and you like the session. Do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. If you have any doubt, then do not hesitate to ask it in the comment section below. I assure you that we will be working on your doubt together. Thank you for watching the video.